side you have this crony capitalism,
yeah,
you know, which sort of is out in all its ugly display. On the other side, you have these incredibly good Indian companies that have given a lot of value back to investors, and they're very high quality in terms of if you look at the metrics like return on equity, consistent earnings growth. India ranks right up there, mm-hmm, compared to any nation in the world, if you take it as a share of the total companies listed out here, which is quite large. So it's a country that we always want to be engaged with.
Sure.
But obviously we keep looking at the fact that what more could be done for India to have, you know, become like the next China. That's really been the sort of dream of so many of us who have sort of been studying development economics and who've been in awe of China's rise since the 1990s. And there I find that no matter what happens, no matter what the politics is, we consistently sort of disappoint in terms of being the next China as an economic story.
You know, Paul Krugman was talking about how there has been a greater degree of convergence between India and the path that advanced economies are taking in the last 30 odd years. But I'll come to China in just a second. I want to, continue to talk about where you see the markets in India, Richard. And you talked about how you continue to be confident in investing in specific Indian companies that meet all the parameters and the matrix that you've laid out for us. Is it harder to find value in India today, given where prices are, given where valuations are?
You know, the biggest cliche in the world I find is that the easy money has already been made, right? Because you look back at the past and you find that it's been done. So I don't think that, you know, like, there's always going to be opportunity out here. Yes, the fact is that a lot of optimism had crept in, and some of that optimism is getting deflated very quickly. But I don't think that this is ever going to be a market which is going to sort of like just tank and you know,
no,
be
but
like,
do you, but do you
be
see
like
a,
Turkey and
do
stuff.
You see
a, I see enough opportunities. I don't think that, yeah, that we are sort of sufficiently engaged. We see enough opportunity. There are enough high quality companies available out here. And the good thing, as I said, about this market, I know there's so much focus on this conference about politics. You know, that how much politics matters, elections are coming up, what's going to happen as far as elections are concerned.
You think it doesn't matter at all?
Exactly.
And or it's limited?
No, I think that the importance of politics in the Indian context is way exaggerated. So I love following politics. I travel every time there's a major election in India. I spend a week traveling with a band of people to figure out what really is happening in that election. It's fascinating. But one thing I've learned over the years is that do not draw any inference from the election results on what's going to happen to the economy or to the markets. Mm. And the markets are very interesting. We think of markets as this sort of very efficient beast. The markets have always been, the Indian market has always been wrong, at least initially, about the politics. Mm. And what do I mean by that? If you look at it, in 2004, when the UPA first came to power, the market was limit down for a couple of days.
Yeah.
It was basically shut. Right? Because there was such pessimism about what would happen under their regime. Instead, you ended up getting one of the biggest bull markets because we had this massive global boom which was going on. 2009, the opposite happened. The UPA gets re-elected, and on the back of that, now all of a sudden, all those same analysts who were skeptical about UPA think that a government's come back, we get political stability, and the market was limit up the next day.
Yeah.
And after that, we had one of the, you know, like a pretty severe downturn as far as the economy was concerned, again because of global reasons. Mm-hmm. In the late 1990s too, similar patterns played out. When the Vajpayee government lost like its vote of confidence by one vote, the market was again sort of limit down, and then like it began its upturn. So my entire point is that it's fascinating to watch politics, but the economy is such and the natural momentum is such that regardless of what happens in politics, a basic sort of trajectory for the economy will continue.
So you're saying that we'll course along on a 7% plus kind of growth rate, whether it's the NDA or another form of government in office at the center. But, you know, every time we talk about 8% plus kind of growth rates, there is this talk about structural reforms. India needs to do structural reforms. You talked about the banking sector, for instance. These require a political majority. These require political will. It requires a significant amount of political capital. So then can politics really be irrelevant to the economic story?
No, I think that we are sort of, underestimating what the Indian polity is all about. Mm. And here again, there was a very interesting survey carried out. This was a World Values survey carried out at the beginning of this decade, where people from different countries were asked, what is your sort of attitude towards the private sector? And India ranked amongst the lowest, which is that most Indians had a very skeptical view of the private sector in terms of that, yeah. that like survey, you know, compared to other countries. So I think that there is no constituency for carrying out the kind of reforms that, you know, like all the sort of economists and the Washington consensus wants the country to do, right? So I think that there was an opportunity possibly in 2015.
It's gone.
In terms of when you, you know, when you had a government with a great majority. Mm-hmm. And it took only a sort of barb about a suit boot ki sarkar and stuff like that for, you know, them to quickly shift course on that. So I think that Feb 2015, when the government really presented its first full budget, that was the one opportunity this government had of trying to do something absolutely dramatic. And I know some proposals like that were on the table then about cutting the sort of tax rates down to ASEAN levels, the corporate tax rate in a very dramatic way to give Make in India a fillip, about possibly even thinking about annulling the Bank Nationalization Act. These proposals were very much on the table. But I think at the last minute, the political will to do anything about it
was limited. Cold feet.
Yeah, partly because I don't think that they felt there's a constituency for this. And it was also partly because, and this is, I think, like, I've had this script for a long time. At the same time, we changed our GDP methodology. So all of a sudden, we started to grow at 7% during the worst of times. And so then the sort of feeling sank in there. If we can do 7% at the worst of times,
why bother?
You know, then why bother doing so much more? And so therefore, I think that that played a real big role out there. So if at all there was a chance for something dramatic to happen, it could have happened, according to me, in 2015. And also because you had a prime minister who has such great oratory skills that he could have tried to market this to a pretty skeptical Indian public. You have to give it to them that the Indian public is quite skeptical of the private sector, and there's still a sort of, you know, great faith in wanting government jobs and stuff. Things have changed, but it's that skepticism is still there. But you had the chance to try and do something very dramatic about it. So that was the only time when I was sort of waiting with bated breath. Otherwise, my sort of approach is that tune out of the politics. It's a total waste of time from an investing standpoint, from knowing where the economy is going to go, and that the country will continue because of its very low per capita income, a very low base. And there's so much penetration opportunity across sectors that the country will keep growing at its, you know, sort of natural buoyancy rate.
So forget about what happens in Phulpur or Gorakhpur, forget about what happens in Karnataka, what may happen in Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh, and of course what is likely to happen in 2019. You believe that in that sense, the Indian economy is more or less decoupled from its politics, and we will continue to traverse this 7% kind of growth rate.
Yeah, you know, like, I don't know about I'm not going to stick myself to 7%, because I think if the global economy has a downturn, there's no way that you get to 7%.
Sure.
And I think that there's a lot which can be done, but I think that that's just the reality of India, which is that we all have a long laundry list of what needs to be done. Some of it gets done, but it's more in the form of sort of incremental changes. When a new government comes to power, they all carry out some incremental changes, and by the time the government ends its term, it gets pretty much into sort of, you know, quite complacent and much more about winning the election through populist schemes. Mm. That's just the pattern as far as India is concerned. But I think that, you know, there's a bigger debate to be had here at some point in time, which is that why in this country is there such sort of skepticism also about the politics? Mm. You know, one of the recent researches that we have done basically shows us this, that 2 out of 3 elections in India are lost. Mm. This is the mirror image of, let's say, the United States.
Okay.
So the United States, we did a similar exercise looking at the presidential elections and looking at the state governor elections. And, you know, there are more than 500 such instances since 1977 in the US as well and India. And what we found here was that in the US, the opposite happens, which is the incumbent ends up winning the election. Mm. And in India,
so
the opposite happens.
There's no anti-incumbency there.
Exactly. I mean, it's very interesting. This term anti-incumbency has been coined in India. So, you know, I mean, like, I'm serious about it. When I try and use the word anti-incumbency in any of my columns, you know, which I write internationally, the editors, like, you know, whether it's the New York Times or the Wall Street Journal, have come back to me and said, what is this term? And I've had to sort of, I think it's a very natural term. But in fact, whoever deserves credit for it, anti-incumbent is the word which has been exclusively coined in India.
And it's an Indian phenomenon.
It's an Indian phenomenon. Because even if you look at the other parliamentary democracies, such as the UK, in the last two elections in the UK, 80% of the sitting members of parliament got re-elected. 80%. You know, so I think that that this is a very...
So what makes it, you know, why is this the case here in India then?
Exactly. And I think that this is where there's not been enough thought given to it. In terms of that, why is it that in India, the default option is throw the bums out, right? So like in India, we keep thinking that what will the politicians do? What will the government do? And what is the Congress party doing, etc.? You know, like it almost doesn't matter. The default option for any party is to lose. Of course, there are one third which win, but it's very interesting that we tried to figure out, is there any common factor as to why these one third of these people who win elections, why do they win elections? And is there a common factor as to why these two thirds of people who lose elections, why they lose elections? I think it's easier to come up with why the two third lose elections based on my travels. And I think the single biggest reason why those two thirds of politicians in India lose power is because the state is broken. And I really believe this, which is that the average person sort of interfaces with, let's say, the local police person, the local tehsildar, the municipality person, the local bureaucrat.
Yeah.
And his or her interface with that is extremely harsh. It's a very tough experience. So even if the chief minister or the prime minister may be well-intentioned, for the daily person dealing with this grind, it is a very, very tough experience. And you can see it in terms of it's oppressive, it is corrupt, and also it is understaffed in terms of, you know, the judiciary and things. So it's a very hard experience. And so the average person basically every 5 years just wants change because he or she perceives that that not much has changed
for me.
Not much has changed for them on the ground. And of course, there are some other peculiarities which make the default option in this country to just throw the bums out. One of them is that it takes very small vote shares, as you know. 4-5% vote swings, and you get massive swings as far as seats are concerned. The other sort of reason, I think, is also because of the fact that the political funding in this country is all done privately. And so winning in like elections has almost become like a business, which is that you need to spend money to win it. And then when you win it, you want to try and recover the money.
Yes.
And it's very tempting not to keep a part of it, right, in terms of as far as the math is concerned. So the allegations of corruption are very easy to stick as far as people are concerned. But I think that this